When it comes to heresy, doctrine that is damnable and not disputable, sometimes it can be easy to spot, and sometimes it isn't. Or in the very least, it's harder to mark a heretic as a heretic. Here are a few examples to give here. A blatant example of heresy would be the Word Faith movement. We get those who blatantly teach heresy, namely Joel Osteen, Benny Hinn, the Copelands, the Crouches, one of whom passed away last year, etc. But there are the more subtle ones, like Joyce Myers. She is subtle in the fact that many claim that her teaching has been very beneficial, but there are also many things that she has taught that are heretical, including her word faith preaching, as well as the Jesus dying spiritually heresy, the dying spiritually in hell heresy. She is not as obvious to spot on the surface from what I observed from others, but certainly her false teaching has been documented. We also have this when it comes to modalism, subject of Itzhak Shapira. If anyone is familiar with what has happened a few years ago, Sam Shamoon and Edward Delcor both examined what Shapira had said in a video response to Yisrael Blumenthal. You can find Edward Delcor's comments in the link below. There are two types of modalism that exist, successive and synonymous, and they both teach that Jesus was a manifestation of God rather than Jesus being a distinct person from the Father and vice versa. Successive modalism teaches that the Father existed at one time, then the Son existed at one time, and then the Spirit existed at another time, and is an earlier form of modalism. Synonymous modalism, however, teaches that all three manifestations coexist at the same time. In both cases, Jesus is all three manifestations, simply taking different roles. The latter is harder to spot, and is funnily enough a common form of modalism that hides in plain sight, and to the untrained eye can easily disguise itself as Trinitarianism, when it isn't, and for the most part is a doctrine that's held to in ignorance. Unlike all forms of modalism, the Trinity teaches in the very being or essence of God, there exist three distinct persons, not three beings in one being or three persons in one person. There are not three separate gods, but one eternal God, which the Tanakh, the Old Testament, and the New Testament make very clear. The Father is not Jesus, Jesus is not the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is not the Father. Modalism, however, does not make this distinction and treats all three persons as manifestations. They do not treat the members of the Godhead as divine persons. Again, as said before, a synonymous modalist is harder to spot than a successive modalist. Just asking them if they believe in the Trinity and pressing them will either reveal the person to be at best ignorant and need education on the Trinity, or at worst believes in a false Christology and will not repent. Universalism is also another example of where the subtle and blatant heresy takes place. It's another example. There is one universalism that proclaims you don't need Jesus to be saved and all paths lead to God. And there is universalism that proclaims Jesus is the only way, but all will be purified in hell and accept him as Lord when he comes to judge the quick and the dead, but only if they have repented will they go to heaven. Both are absurd, and it's an obvious given that Unitarian Universalism is false. But the other form of universalism, a Trinitarian universalism, is harder to deal with, as the concept of hell isn't necessarily denied, and possibly in some cases, one could be an annihilationist and be a universalist at the same time. It really depends on the individual who holds these views. I have already spoken on universalism in other papers, namely some of the biblical references used, as well as looking at some of the church fathers on the subject, to see whether or not they taught it. You can look at the links in the description below. The latter form of universalism I've mentioned seems to allow for one to proclaim that Jesus is the only way to heaven, while adding the idea that all will be saved by Christ's death after a time in hell, with repentance of course, and that Jesus brings the unbelievers out of hell later. It's just as deplorable as Unitarian Universalism, while at the same time trying to shoehorn itself into biblical Christianity. Satan never tells an outright lie. He mixes truth with lies. This is why sometimes people inadvertently accept people who may have a false heretical belief. We must be on our guard against false heretical beliefs. The same scenario for the other groups I mentioned also apply to Roman Catholics and Mormons, especially when they claim faith in Jesus or claim that they themselves believe in God's grace, when the truth is they mean something different from what biblical Christianity means by grace. A definition of certain terms is important to clarify, as your definition of grace may not be the same as theirs. As Jacob Prash once observed, people have no problem calling Charles Taze Russell or Joseph Smith false prophets, but an unjust balance is an abomination to the Lord, and the scriptures themselves make clear that we must not have uneven scales or unequal measures, for the Lord detests them both. Look at Proverbs 20:10 and 20:23 for more information. I say this because of the Kansas City prophets, which would include Paul Kane, Rick Joyner, Mike Bickle, Lou Engel, the late John Paul Jackson, Cindy Jacobs, and others. We are so quick to point out the false prophets that lead the Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, and Islam, yet we fail to overlook the numerous false proclamations of the Kansas City prophets. Why do we examine one but not the other? Deuteronomy 18:20, despite its dismissal by many, still holds weight today that false prophets are to be rejected should they have even one false prophecy. While under the New Covenant we are not to stone false prophets, as found in Deuteronomy 18:20, this doesn't downplay the seriousness of false prophecy, and the person who made the prediction should be rebuked, brought to repentance, and must cease involvement in the prophetic ministry. Contrary to the claims of the KC prophets, JWs, and Mormons, one prophecy is enough to disqualify you from being in that office. Heresy can be blatantly seen, or in some cases it can be well hidden, and needs to be investigated to see it for what it is. But it doesn't change the fact that both are equally as dangerous. Guard yourselves, lest you fall. Thank you for taking the time to watch.